And away we go. Right. I am spirit. I am free. Indeed, that is the truth. Welcome to the video. Go big to go home. This is sort of a new catchphrase we have. Go big to go home. Go big to go home. If we want to go home, we have to go big. So, every day, at least I'm trying to transcend what I did yesterday and go even bigger. This is a great discipline, a great way to look at it. Today I'm working on all sorts of... I wrote a 6-page explanation of the practice, full stop in the wow practice, and we'll talk about that here. I have a lot of pictures going up on the internet, a lot of graphics. So some writing, some graphics. I have some links here to the website. This is it. It's on the heading of the YouTube page on the right there. There's links, you know, various links to various sites. And it's just all, I'm just all starting just to, you know, gear up. Let's go big, go really big. And just start dumping the bigness into the world. This is what we have seen. It's happening. It's happening. That there's a new spirit. There's a feeling right now that we need to go big, right? It's a feeling that we need to go big, and this feeling is resonating now throughout the world. We realize this is it. This is it. Go big to go home. You know, go big to go home. If we go small, we're not going to go home, will we? We have to realize the enormity of the moment of these times and say, hey, this is our opportunity, because we really do have a streamlined teaching here called Full Stop in the Wow. It's really a fresh, very fresh, with a new context that we're not used to. So everybody's a beginner here. This is something that needs to be emphasized. When you start out with Full Stop in the Wow, you're a beginner. It doesn't matter if you're an expert in some other way. It doesn't matter, because it's like apples and oranges. It's like someone saying, well, I'm an expert on the piano, and they pick up the guitar and say, well, I mean, it's a whole different thing, right? I mean, sure, if you're an expert in one instrument, you might be able to become an expert in another fairly rapidly. That's great. But still, first time you pick up a guitar, you don't know how to play it. And so really this Full Stop in the Wow practice is a new, fresh teaching for the context, the beautiful, beautiful context that we have and the times that we're in. The whole thing is just new and fresh. So everybody comes to it as a beginner, but it's so easy to do that very rapidly you can become proficient in this and just say, wow, this really works. It's just an awesome practice. I'm not going to spend any time comparing it with what came before, because that gets very cumbersome. We don't have the time. We're just saying it's a very, very effective practice. And you could characterize this. I'm going to put links to this write-up that I've done, 6-page write-up. It's on my blog. It's on Facebook. It's on various places. I've put it up, posted it. And even posted it in replies here, although the formatting doesn't turn out very good. What was I saying? Let's keep going. What this is really saying, this teaching, it's fabulous. It says this teaching comes from Jesus and the Holy Spirit, and what it says, what they're saying is that all we have to do is avoid not judging against truth, to not judge against it. We don't have to judge for it. This is what, in fact, Jesus tells us, don't get struggle to judge for it. Don't do that. Why? This is where we've gone wrong in the past. We tried to judge for truth. Yes, I'm judging for truth. Truth is true. I got to judge for it. This is the mistake we make. Because truth doesn't need our judgment to be true at all. It doesn't need any judgment. When we get into our judging mind and trying to judge, we put this block. We put a block. We block ourselves from truth, because truth simply is. There is no judgment involved. It doesn't need our judgment. It doesn't need to be judged. It doesn't need for us to say, oh yes, truth, I'm judging that you're true. It's already true. It's always been true. It's just there as truth. So we don't have to judge it. It automatically says yes to itself. This yes attracts us, automatically attracts us, but we have to stay out of judgment. Now, there's a further issue with judgment, and that is we are so accustomed to judging against truth, so accustomed to it. This entire existence is judging against truth. It's judging that we're dead, that spirit's dead, judging that spirit has guilt from killing God. This is all judgment against truth. We're so used to that, that as soon as we start going into judgmental mode, it's very easy and almost inevitable that we will slip back into judging against truth. And then that really blocks us, you know, very severely. So what Jesus says is just don't judge at all. When go into this neutral mode, which we can call maybe. I call full stop in the wow. Maybe yes, maybe no. Is truth true? Or maybe truth is true, maybe it isn't true. I don't know. I'm just going to stay in neutral. Now, what does this do? It knocks out judgment against truth, right? All right, because you're saying, I don't know. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. But you're not judging against it. So as soon as you stop judging against truth, the inherent attractiveness of truth within our mind, we begin to gravitate towards that automatically, even without judging for truth at all. So this is the genius of this practice. Is what we do is we hear, we read, we see, we're in the presence of truth somehow, and it seeps into us and we begin to hear, you know, begin to get it, say, oh my gosh, this is true, this is true, oh my gosh. And this produces this wow feeling. And what we do with this wow feeling is we go into full stop in the wow, neutral mode, neither yes nor no, maybe yes, maybe no, I'm just neutral on this. And we stay in this neutral mode. What this does is it suspends judgment against truth. We're not judging against it in any way. And again, keep in mind, we don't need to judge for it. So the important issue is don't judge at all. Because judgment is other than the final judgment, which is to judge that we don't need any judgments. All judgments are really judging against truth in one way or the other. So just don't judge. We don't need it. This is why full stop on the wow. We're just wow. We're not saying anything. We're not thinking. We're not striving. We're not struggling. Not trying to go forward. Not trying to go in reverse or side. Just doing nothing. We're just sitting here still. Just sitting here. Not doing anything. So it's like, maybe, yeah, maybe I'll do this, maybe I'll do that, maybe I won't, maybe I will, but I'm staying in the maybe-ness of it. I'm not doing anything. I'm not judging. Automatically, then, this enables one to be, one will gravitate towards truth automatically. So this is, you know, just a tremendous, tremendous boost right now to have this teaching here. And it's quite simple. It's quite simple. All one has to do is practice it. Now, I've said that just because, you know, someone may be very erudite, spiritually erudite, or, you know, very intelligent, with genius, spiritual genius, that doesn't mean they can do the practice, but a simpleton can also do the practice. It doesn't automatically mean that they're going to be good at the practice just like that. A simpleton could be just as good as a genius. It's just a matter of doing it. It's just a matter of being determined to be not judgmental. So being erudite doesn't help you and doesn't block you. It doesn't help or hinder. Being a simpleton doesn't help or hinder, really. Everyone can do it. Everyone, no one has some kind of innate, you know, advantage over it. Innate advantage. We hear a lot of talk in the world about who has the inside track of spirituality, who has the advantage. No, nobody has the advantage. It's your determination to stop failing. You know, because the problem we have is we're pretending, spirits pretending to be dead in order to satisfy imaginary guilt. And When spirit does this, in order to pretend to be dead, it's got to pretend like it doesn't understand. It fails. It has to fail, right? I mean, if spirit was not dead, then surely it couldn't fail at this. It would be a piece of cake, and boom, that's it. So instead, spirit is failing. It's struggling. Oh, I can't do it this way. I can't struggle like failing. I can't. So the great block is failure. We think we have to stay in role of failing to succeed. At awakening, we keep stumbling around and failing. This is our trouble. We don't practice. We say, "Oh yeah, okay, I'll get around to that sometime," but I can't do it yet because, well, I'm dead. You know, I'm dead. How can a dead spirit do this? Can't. We can think about doing it, but we can't really do it. And so most never get around to it. And there's all sorts of clever excuses that we use to stay in role, staying, well, I'm dead spirit, so I just can't succeed. I just can't succeed. No. And so we stay away from any sort of successful practice. This is what's happened throughout history, is we stay away from any sort of successful practice. That's why, huge number have succeeded. Most will put on the spectacle of practicing, being spiritual and righteous and all this stuff, but they never actually get around to practicing. They do something that doesn't work, and then they say, oh, I tried, but I failed. And therefore, they feel that, they've continued to pretend to be dead, and hopefully that will satisfy guilt, and they'll be free of guilt, and then we can say, yeah, we're greater than God, and we don't even have any guilt anymore over it. You see, we're completely free, we're free and clear. Never works that way. So, for more on this, you can look at that write-up. It's on the blog. I'll put the links down, and just read it and consider it, because this is how to truly get into what actually works. Be determined to do it. Neutral mind. Don't judge against truth. Don't judge against it. That's all that's required, and this is the secret. You don't have to judge for it. In fact, don't judge for it. Just make sure you don't judge against it. This is the great genius, and I just realized it this morning very clearly. Had some difficult dreams. I had a really great dream, and then suddenly the dream became very difficult. And I was like, "Wow, this is not good, Louis. We gotta go better. Go faster, go better than this." And so I was able to get this higher clarity up coming through, where you simply don't judge against truth. That's the whole secret to it. And we just practice this. We simply practice it. And it's not very difficult. It's not very difficult. But the whole difficulty is to actually start doing it. Because when we start doing it, we're no longer pretending to be dead. That's the problem, right? This is why everyone's scared. Everyone's scared to start practicing this way. Because it's obvious right off the bat, you'll realize, oh my gosh, this is going to succeed, and I'm no longer going to be pretending to be dead, and it's quite a wow, it's quite a shock. But if those who are very determined, those who are very tired of waiting for guilt to disappear, and of course, how do you make zero disappear? How do you make nothing disappear? Guilt is all, we made it up, it doesn't exist. So how can it disappear? It cannot really disappear. We have to realize it was never there. We can't believe that guilt is real and then get rid of it. Because if guilt is real, that means we have killed ourselves. I did commit suicide. And if we did, then, this is all, obviously we didn't, because we're struggling to get rid of guilt. So guilt is indeed imaginary. That's the effect that when we tried to change the will of God, nothing happened. Nothing happened. And we said, wow. Nothing happened. How's that possible? And we said, no, something must have happened. So then we imagined guilt as the effect of changing the will of God. That now, that, of course, since we're one with God, we are extension of God. If we change the will of God, we're essentially annihilating God. We're essentially annihilating ourselves. So in order to imagine that we did change the will of God, we have to basically play dead. Play dead. That's the price. We say, here's the guilt, the terrible feeling. It's also struck us, and we're dead too. God is dead, so we're dead too. Except we're only pretending to be dead, and we're trying to trick guilt into believing that we're dead, and then it will vanish, leave us alone, and then we can be happy and be greater than God and be happy. This is essentially what's going on, and it's ludicrous, but this is what's going on. It's the result of trying to insist that there was a result from changing the will of God. But, of course, that result would hit us too, wouldn't it? So instead of, well, we thought, instead of like being annihilated, we say, wait a minute, I'll pretend to be annihilated. I'll pretend, and maybe guilt will buy that. That maybe I can survive my own annihilation by pretending quickly, pretend to be annihilated, and then in a flash, so we pretended to be annihilated. But it's all pretense. It's all breakdown. Spirit is not annihilated in the slightest bit. And there is no guilt to, you know, play possum, play dead to at all. It doesn't exist. We are imagining it exists so that we can imagine we can get rid of it. See, we're imagining that we feel guilty so that we can then imagine that we can get rid of it. Now, so this is just a discourse, just talking, flipping the script. And in listening to this, whatever you're doing, you should always be trying to go for the wow. Go big, which means go for the wow. Go big. And when you get to the wow, you start feeling this feeling of like, wow, this is elation and trepidation, fear. You're saying like, wow, this is great, but I'm kind of nervous. It's so great. Oh, wow, I can't even measure this. This is immeasurable, immeasurably great. You get that wow. That's when you go into neutral mode to say, okay, I don't need to judge for this. Neither do I need to judge against it. I'm not going to go into my judgmental mind on this. I'm going to stay abstract, non-judgmental. Jesus said, judge not lest you be judged. Very, very important. Judge not lest you be judged, right? So if you're judging for truth, you easily, in your judgmental mind, you will slip back to what's familiar and feel safe, and you'll judge against yourself, saying, no, This death is real. You know, the spirit pretending to be dead. I have to do that. I'm judging against truth. You'll easily slip into judging against truth. So judge not, lest ye be judged. Super great advice. Now, we're in this time in the world right now where all amazing stuff is happening, actually, and it will continue and continue. And let us be part of the continuation of it. And we hear a lot about tolerance and just, hey, get used to it, get over your objections to this and this and that, you know. Well, I would submit it's time for people to get over their objections to Jesus, you know. Start being tolerant and getting over their objections to Jesus. I mean, their objections are based on straw men that fear has made throughout thousands of years, where fear thought that Jesus is going to help us, you know, get rid of guilt by being dead, and that will get rid of guilt, and it didn't work out that way. And so people have distorted. Fear has distorted, and arrogance has distorted, and we made it seem like Jesus is here to help us play dead, you know. And then people are attacking these straw men that have been made, which is, and then thinking that, okay, a guy, you know, I demolished this straw man, and now therefore Jesus doesn't exist. This is the one of the oldest tricks in the book, that we make a false image of some person made out of straw, you know, someone we're afraid of, make a person out of straw, and then we attack the straw man and tear the straw man apart, and then we think, ah, I have vanquished that my enemy, you know, I'm no longer afraid. Yet, of course, it doesn't have anything to do with the person. And so there's so many straw men of Jesus out there that people are attacking and saying, oh, Jesus is terrible, terrible, look at this. But if you really give Jesus a true listen, which I feel he absolutely deserves, if you give him a second look, you realize, hey, wait a minute, you know, this is a fabulous teacher. This is someone who knows their business and knows how to liberate us from this insane nightmare. And so I think the world needs to get over their objections to Jesus and stop bringing up, you know, the Catholic Church did this and this and this. Well, those are fearful people building straw men and helping, you know, reinforce the dream of death as everybody has, and trying to keep pretending to be dead and et cetera, et cetera, like we all are. And that's, what does that have to do with Jesus, you know, really? Really, I mean, we can make up stuff about anybody. And does that mean that the person that we're made up stuff about is bad, is wrong? That's ridiculous. Yeah, so people think, oh, yeah, Jesus, I know. Yeah, Jesus is like this. I don't need to listen to him. I already know what he's like. You know, nonsense. Most people have not given him a fair listen at all. All I did was give him a fair listen. He earned it. You know, he earned it. He did a lot of work. He's done a lot of work. He made A Course in Miracles available. And I said, okay, fair enough. You know, you did. I could see. You did a lot of work here. Let me at least be honest enough to take a look and see, you know, what you have to say. Give you a fair hearing. Let's give you a fair hearing. And so I gave Jesus a fair hearing, and I continue to. And I say, wow. You know, wow. You know, he's not anything like what religion presents him as at all. Just maybe the opposite. I mean, religion presents Jesus as somebody that, you know, that actually succeeded in making the death of spirit real. And by doing so, then atoned to guilt and satisfied guilt, and then somehow resurrected after making death real, then somehow got free of it. And if we just believe in that, then we're going to live happily ever after. You know, this is not what Jesus actually did. and this is our hope, that a Savior will come to the world and truly die. You see, we're just spirit pretending to die. But we know it's a pretense, and we're nervous. We think, wow, this might not be good enough, and we might actually end up being truly annihilated, you know? Somehow we're avoiding annihilation. We killed God, but somehow magically we're avoiding that annihilation that we thought would fall on us. But we still have this dreadful guilt that we must atone for. And so we think we look for a Messiah, a Savior, to come here, that spirit, and come here and then truly die. And then we think, oh, okay, guilt will then have to accept this true death of spirit, and then it will no longer ask for our deaths. So they say, well, God sent his only beloved son, so loved the world that he sent his only beloved son, you know, to die for our sins, and, you know, to save us, to die for us, you know. This is not what Jesus has to say at all. This is what we are hoping for. So we just stuck a round peg into a square hole, essentially. You know, here's Jesus, the round peg, and we say, thank you, and then try to jam it into the square hole and say, okay, this is what you did. Basically dictating to Jesus what it is he came to do and tell us. And, you know, that doesn't work. That doesn't work. Doesn't work. But we hope it works. We don't feel there's any other way. But there is a way. That way doesn't work. But there is a way to gradually get over this fear we have of awakening. Now, it's very important to point out that we don't have to drop pretending altogether like that. Okay, I always talk about the intermediate step. It's so important. This is what Jesus talks about. He says there's an intermediate step. And this is what he's leading us to, this intermediate step. So let's talk a little bit about this intermediate step. Now, we're doing all this because Jesus is back. He's pushing this agenda. He's putting, I'm feeling the pressure. I said, I got to get this. I got to keep going big here. Come on. The time is now. So we're pushing this. Now, this intermediate step here. We're so used to pretending. We've been pretending that we're dead. Okay, that's the realm of impermanence, is spirit pretending to be dead. It's all a pretense. Spirit could drop it in an instant, any instant. But it's so used to pretending that spirit now thinks that its functioning is to pretend. It thinks that pretending is its function. So it feels that if pretending stopped, it wouldn't know how to function. This is called the continuity fear, okay? It's called the continuity fear. So what we can do, what Jesus advises us, is in essence to don't stop pretending, but change what you're pretending. Right now, spirit's pretending to be dead. Okay, we don't like that. You know, spirit is not happy pretending to be dead. I mean, it's just waiting, you know, for guilt to go away, but it doesn't. You know, waiting for zero to go away. So what we do is, instead of pretending to be dead, we pretend to be eternal life. Okay, we can do that. We can pretend to be eternal life. And this is the key. We continue to pretend. But when we pretend to be eternal life, then it's very easy to set down pretending altogether. It becomes very, very easy to set down all pretending altogether. Because when we pretend to be eternal life, this is very close to actually being eternal life, right? Now, the death-free realm is an example of pretending to be eternal life. I have been in the death-free realm, and it was absolutely wondrous because nothing there had ever died. Nothing there had ever died. There was plants, massive trees and plants and shrubs and greenery and flowers and everything. None of it had ever, ever died. So this is pretending to be eternal life, pretending to be eternal life. And there is this realm which is our imagining that presents to our perception this scenario of imagining to be eternal life. Now, so our goal is to imagine to be eternal life, and we can do this even while we're still here in this world, actually. And I'm not going to get into the nuts and bolts of that. But certainly, this is our goal. And we do this by dropping our judgment, because remember, truth doesn't need to be judged to be true. Not at all. It doesn't need our judgment. So what we have to simply guard against is guard against judging against truth, because then that definitely will cause us to be afraid, definitely cause us to be fearful and continue to pretend to be dead. So we must guard against judging against truth. So this whole idea that Jesus is trying to force religion on us or force, it is not true. He's merely telling us how to practice successfully. And he doesn't say, you must judge that truth is true. You must accept this judgment. You must, you know. He's saying, no, just suspend your judgment against truth. That's all. And automatically then you will be attracted. The attractiveness of truth is within us already. So when you make the playing field neutral, you will automatically then be attracted to what is most attractive. The attraction of truth is so powerful, even though you're going neutral mind, it still pulls you in that direction. You know, you just need to stop pulling away from it, right? Okay. Now, we're in a great time right now, and a lot of people might be intimidated by organized religion and by the institutions that have helped us pretend to be dead, which is just about everything in this world has basically helped us to pretend to be dead. This is what we've done. We've crafted an entire realm, entire universe, that its purpose is to help us pretend to be dead. It's, and we're so clever at it. And we've done a very shrewd, clever job at this. So there's so many institutions and teachings and teachers and all, you know, just everywhere seem to be saying, you know, you got to continue to pretend to be dead. If you don't, you're going to cause us to be annihilated. You know, and they put so much pressure on you. And I use an example of these times. These times are very interesting right now. And I want people to seize the moment. Carpe diem, seize the moment. It's so important. I'm trying to seize the moment and trying to set an example. The spirit of the times is to no longer be intimidated by the bullying of these institutions, okay? And to say, no, I'm going to practice. I'm just going to suspend judgment altogether. And I'm going to do it. I don't care, you know, what this says. I mean, Jesus is already back. I mean, you think that he's going to the Pope and saying, hey, Pope, what do you want me to do? You know, no. He said, who wants to relate? I raised my hand. I said, okay. And then he started relating, talking with me. We had a conversation. And from that, I've gone full blast in trying to, you know, working to break the ice on all of this. So he's simply relating in friendship to those who want to relate in friendship, and emphasizing this genius of this practice. There is a practice that actually works, and I'm seeing it more and more and more and more now. Why does it work? I understand why it works. We're simply not judging against truth. We just stop judging against truth, and we're automatically then attracted to truth that way. And this full stop in the wow, we put our mind in neutral mode. Now we can assert the truth a little bit. It's not that asserting the truth is a bad thing. It's fine. But when we get the reaction of wow, that's when we stop and make sure we're not struggling. Make sure we're not struggling. So I say, don't struggle with the struggle. The wow is already a struggle. Just let that be and let that happen. But go into neutral mind. Maybe yes, maybe no. I'm not judging one way or the other. I am not judging whether you see the truth, you know it's true, right? As soon as you get into judgment, you're damning it with faint praise. Don't damn the truth with faint praise. Just go into neutral mode, and your spirit will awaken your spirit from this awful dream. And where do we go? We go into pretending that we are eternal life, pretending that we are eternal life instead of pretending that we're dead, which is this realm of impermanence. Now, in the United States of America, it's a very interesting situation. We have this presidential race starting up. You know, starts about a year and a half ahead of time. And we have this character on the stage we call the Donald Trump. And what's happening is he has no fear of the media whatsoever. And this is astonishing for the citizens of the United States, because we have been so bullied and intimidated and cowed and crushed by the media. in the United States, that to see somebody just stand up there with no fear is an astonishment. And we're just like, what? It's hard to believe. And we say, hey, wait a minute. When you see that, you say, hey, wait a minute. Maybe I don't have to be so, maybe I don't have to keep cowering in fear, you know? It's possible. You know, he says, boom, 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 okay, I'm done, that's it, we're finished here, and that's it. It's like, what? You can't do that to the media. They'll kill you, you know, they'll crush you, they'll destroy you. And he just doesn't even seem bother at all. It doesn't matter who it is. And so this is like, you know, America's just like on the edge of their chair saying, whoa, you mean, you know, the media is not all powerful? You mean it's possible, you know, that we don't have to just, you know, collapse and turn into jello? You know, we have all these pajama boys and girls, whenever they say something that social media doesn't like, they go, oh, I'm so sorry, oh my gosh, it's horrible, I'm just so apologetic, I don't want to say anything that might bother anybody. I was, oh, and they just go through this massive, like, what is this, the inquisitional torture. I'd say, my gosh, I'm guilty, I'm sinful, I'm wrong, I'm terrible, I'm this, and this is being amplified to everybody, and not just America, around the world, saying, you know, we've got to, maybe I'm gonna go over to a graphic here, because this sun is, if I can even see, let me see. Okay, there you go. Very nice. We'll even go to another one if I can. So we here in America are waking up in a certain way, just saying, hey, wait a minute, we do not have to grovel in front of all-powerful institutions, right? We do not have to grovel. I don't know if this is going to change. It's not. It's okay. And it goes on. And we'd say, hey, the spirit is now saying, wait a minute, you know. What have I been groveling towards? I mean, do we have to grovel to the Catholic Church or the Pope or something? No. I mean, do I have to put what Jesus is saying so the Pope agrees with it? And no, I don't have to agree. You know, you got a question? What's your question? Don't lecture me, you know. What's your question? Okay, I'll answer your question. That was a lousy question. I'm not going to answer that question. Next question. You know, we can stand up for ourselves now. We can realize, hey, let's start standing up for ourselves. So, there you go. coming soon to a place near you. Let's start standing up for our spiritual truth. Let's start standing up for Jesus. Let's stop letting these institutions define Jesus for us, you know. Just like the cartel in Washington, the cartel and the regime in Washington thinks that they get to, and the media thinks that they get to choose who the candidate is. They get to choose who the president is. And Trump's saying, no, wait a minute. The people get to choose. You don't get to choose. And they're saying, what? You know, everybody's saying, huh? Really? We get to choose? I thought we didn't get to choose. I thought the media decided, you know, who's good and who's bad. And so, you know, we don't have to let those who've made straw men of Jesus, you know, tell us, you know, can we be a friend of Jesus or not? Can we be a friend of Jesus or not? We don't have to let them tell us that. I said, hey, we'll decide whether we can be a friend of Jesus or not. We'll decide to friend Jesus. So, you know, we can friend Jesus, okay? We can friend Jesus. We can actually do that. We don't have to wait for the Pope to tell us, you know, how to do that and whether we should and what the teaching is, etc., etc., or anybody else, actually. The closer we can get it to the horse's mouth, the better. And I've tried to work with Jesus for 40 years, almost 40 years, and probably before I even came into this world, so I can deliver as clear a message as possible and simple as possible, saying, you know, what all you want to be a friend of Jesus, start practicing this full stop and the wow. Nothing makes Jesus happier, more delighted than to see that some of us are practicing, because it works. This is what works. Don't judge against truth. And the way to do that is go into neutral mode. The way to do that is to go into neutral mode. Evaporate your belief that you are a body. Indeed, indeed, indeed. Yeah. And ultimately, we're doing this. So let's go through some graphics here. Ah, the Holy Spirit, the wonderful Holy Spirit. So I've been making these graphics to help people out, you know, just give them a little boost graphically. I mean, there's a lot of graphics out in the world, and people feel like, you know, if I don't have graphics, maybe I'm falling behind. So I'm making these graphics. They're not, you know, very important one way or the other, but some people like them. Some people it helps them, so that's fine. What's important is to practice. Now, when you get this wow feeling, don't frantically try to judge positively for spirit, for truth. You'll trip up. You'll get in your own way. The wow's already there. It means you've already accepted it in, you know, into your mind. Now you may need to make sure you don't judge against it, that you don't have a boomerang effect. Because when you're struggling with words and concepts, it's super easy to start getting a boomerang effect, and then you start judging against it. Before you know it, suddenly you're saying, ah, this doesn't work, this is bad, blah, 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 and you're judging against it. This is what you have to guard against. You really have to guard against this. Now, the institutions of religion are not teaching you this teaching at all. They're not teaching you this practice, right? So I just bypassed all of that and went straight to Jesus. I said, Jesus, how do you want us to practice? And this is what has come from that, from the Holy Spirit and from Jesus. So we need in these times to be prepared, right? Because there's a lot of turmoil coming, a lot of flames coming, a lot of very intense heat is coming as far as turmoil goes, and in many ways. So we need to be prepared. We need to practice this very simple practice. Those who do it will certainly be saved. Okay, and those who don't, no matter how erudite they may be, they may have read, you know, 10,000 spiritual books, but if they don't practice, they're very likely to miss the boat, because this practice is extraordinarily simple and yet effective. One must not judge against truth in order to be safe. One must do that, and you have to go into neutral mode. You have to suspend your judgment, even though that means suspending positive judgment too. That doesn't matter. You see, that doesn't matter. And this is the all-important realization. It doesn't matter. In suspending, now, zero times anything equals zero. Yeah. That's right. You know, we're very true. We must suspend our judgment. This is the key. This is the key to success. There you go. Jesus coming soon to a place near you. Indeed, indeed, indeed. He's already back. And you want to know Jesus? Practice this. Practice this. Practice this. Full stop in the wow. Practice it. As I've been urging in so many, many videos and presenting opportunities to do so, just keep practicing it. Just keep going big every day. Get to the wow. Like, wow, I just had this great dream. Or wow, I just had this great insight. Wow, I've been asserting the truth. And I'm feeling this just awesome reverberation of like, oh my gosh, I'm so close. Then suspend judgment. Don't be for it or against it. Suspend your judgment. This is the secret, the key to successful spiritual practice. And this is all that Jesus is telling us. He's not laying too much on us. I know A Course in Miracles laid a lot on us, but that was necessary to get us going, okay? We were in a situation where we thought truth must be very complex, okay, because we were in a psychoanalytic time, and a scientific psychoanalytic time, and we thought, you know, everything was really complicated and very complex with many layers and levels and all this kind of stuff, and we wouldn't listen to anybody who came in and said, just do the simple practice, that's all you need. You know, we're very resistant to that. And so Jesus had to do a lot of filler to make sure, you know, he presented it over and over and over and over again in many, many different angles. And that was necessary. And I appreciate it. Now, it's not so necessary to do that, really. It's not. We need to just get to the straight truth of it all. Just straight talk, straight practice here. Just get right to it. And there you go. Jesus saves today. Indeed, Jesus does save today. In fact, Jesus saves today more than ever, because we now have this practice, which is so intensely successful and effective. I've just had tremendous dreams and breakthroughs while practicing this, since I've been practicing this. Just, I'm not going to even try and measure what the progress has been like. It's been so great. And anyone who practices this way will have tremendous progress. as long as they actually, you know, do it. Instead of, you know, conceptualize and think about it, actually do it. Get to the wow. Don't be afraid of the wow, because you already know what you're going to do. You're going to full stop. You're going to suspend judgment. See? So if you know what you're going to do, you're not afraid of the wow. You say, whatever comes, I'll just suspend judgment, and I don't have to advocate it, nor to be against it. See, when you, even if you see, you know, oh my gosh, I see freedom, I see my freedom, everything, you don't try to be an advocate for it. Suspend your judgment, full stop on the wow. And then, for sure, you won't be judging against it. You will not be judging against it. I'm back. I am back. May 1st, that's right. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Jesus did return approximately May 1st, 2:15. At least that's when the announcement, approximately that's when the announcement, he made this announcement that I'm back. Now, he may have been hanging out here for a little while, I don't know, but the announcement, for all intents and purposes, when he announced, I am back, that means, that's when he, you know, officially saying, okay, now I'm back. And great timing. So, while the mood in the world is that of standing up to the tyranny of institutions that tell us how we have to think, you know, the media is such a bully. You know, for me, the media is the worst institution in the world. Nothing even comes close. They think that they can bully everybody into going along with the narrative that they think that we should be going along with. And they're quite astounded when someone doesn't go along with it. It's like something's wrong with the universe, you know. It's like they're acting like the laws of nature have somehow been breached. So, it's extraordinary. I've never been an I've never been a me. Where I am now is where I really want to be. Amen and amen and amen to that, right? We'll just go quiet for a little bit here. I've never been an I've never been a me. Where I am now is where I really want to be. Now maybe we can get a wow from this graphic. It's possible, right? It's quite a powerful graphic. I've never been an I, I've never been a me. All this dreamed of death, this dream of suffering, impermanence, has never really happened to anyone. We keep thinking that it's happening to an I or a me. There's someone it's happening to. It's not happening to anyone. It's not happening to spirit. I mean, just the same way that a dream isn't really happening to the dreamer. The stuff in the dream is not really happening to the dreamer at all. So too, what's happening in this realm of impermanence, this dream of impermanence, is not really happening to spirit at all. It's not happening to anyone. And realizing this is where I am now, and it's where I really want to be. Absolutely it is. Yeah, we're in a journey beyond words, that's for sure. We're in a journey beyond words. Into suspending judgment, where you don't need it, don't have any words. Don't let words intrude when you're in the full stop and the wow. Just go quiet, no words. Silent, quiet, no words, no judgment. No positive words, no negative words. This is the tremendous, tremendous key to the kingdom. Very simple. And yet very few will try it because they think that'll blow my cover. When I start, this will blow my cover. I can't, you know, this doesn't seem like I'm still dead. So we ask the Holy Spirit to help us accept truth. Ask the Holy Spirit to help us get started on this. Ask the Holy Spirit to help us get started on this. Ask the Holy Spirit. Let's friend Jesus and ask the Holy Spirit to help us out, and it will. So, you know, the world needs to start friending Jesus. We're friending all sorts of people, but how about friending Jesus? How about friending Jesus? That is what is key. What is the world? Well, it's spirit faking its death to try and trick guilt. But guilt doesn't exist. And I can't read the rest. Tell a friend. Tell a friend about this, that there's this great practice. You know, tell a friend. Tell a friend. Tell a friend. I've always been blissful. I've always been free. The dream of death has never touched me. Because I'm spirit. Dream of death has never touched me. This is true for everyone. It's true for me. It's true for you. Truth is indeed simple. Truth is simple. Spirit can never attack God, so there can be no associated guilt. Therefore, there is no need for spirit to try and get rid of non-existent guilt, right? Therefore, spirit doesn't need to fake its own suicide to try and appease guilt. So there is no need for the realm of impermanence. No need for bodies and worlds. There's no need for any of this. There is no need for any of this, actually. But because we're so used to pretending, right? So we're so used to pretending that we don't want to give up pretending yet. So let's pretend, instead of that we're dead, let's pretend that we're eternal life. Rejoice. Death is only a dream. Rejoice. Death is only a dream. So, friend Jesus. Go ahead and friend Jesus. Now, you can use these pictures that are public domain. Okay, put them in public domain. I'm not going to claim ownership of these pictures. If you want to use them and to help you, you know, help you friend Jesus and get into this, then by all means do so. Friend Jesus, rejoice. Death is only a dream. Friend Jesus. All right, so we need to start friending Jesus. This is plain and simple. I tried to make a Facebook page. Let me pump the light up here, though the sun has set down. And so I said, okay, let me make a Facebook page to help people out, and I'll post pictures there now. Do that, and I have made a page, and the link is, I'll put down below the description of this video and on the right of the home, YouTube dashboard or YouTube home, is the link. But I said, okay, so what was the name of your Facebook page? And I said, well, the name is Jesus, and the Facebook says, page, you have chosen a term which is not allowed. I said, okay, Jesus Christ. Again, it said, you have chosen a word that is not allowed on this site. Wow. Well, not allowed in your page. You can't have a page saying Jesus. You can't have a page saying Jesus Christ. So I put Christ and says, you are not allowed to use this word. You can't have a page saying Christ. You can't have a page saying Jesus Christ. You can't have a page saying Jesus. I was like, I took a screenshot of that, and I was astonished. Astonished by this. Facebook is yeah, it is, that says a lot right there. So I had to come up with something, the great news about Jesus, something like him. I can't remember what it was, but the link's there. But the great news about Jesus, facebook.com, the great news about Jesus, something like that. And it's basically updates. I'm just going to posting updates about this great rollout, this new dispensation of Jesus. He's back, and he's not coming empty-handed. He already helped us prepare by giving A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, and The Other Voice, which helped clarify A Course in Miracles, and gave us, like, it's now been about, 40-plus years to prepare. So I used all that time to prepare. This is what I've done with my life. I just used all that time to prepare. So he comes back now and he says, well, so I hope some of you are prepared. I gave you, you know, a lot of time. You've had over 2,000 years, but also I gave you some updated help. So, I mean, I hope some of you are, you know, have prepared. And so he has a new dispensation. He has a new rollout right now. And I mean, he's going to do something. And so, you know, we know what to do. Practice, right? We're not all freaked out at all. I'm not freaked out by Jesus being here at all. I know what the practice is. I know what he'll suggest. So just practice this. Don't judge. Suspend judgment. Sure, build up the wow. You got to build up the wow. Just say yes, truth, you know, truth is true, truth is true. We're not judging it, we're asserting it. There's a difference between judging and asserting. When you're making these assertions, you're not in judgmental mind at all. This is very important. And you can feel the shift in your mind. You say, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. You're speaking from the totally abstract position of truth. There's no ambiguity at all. You're just stating the truth. You're not trying to judge what you're saying, or the goal, or anything. You're just asserting, straight out asserting. So that's really not judgment. But when you do this assertion, you will feel this wow. And then you must not struggle with the wow. You must go into this neutral mode. Don't say anything. Don't push forward. Don't go backwards. Don't retreat, advance. Don't do anything. Don't... You know, just suspend your judgment. Suspend your judgment. Don't even make any assertions. Don't do anything. Just don't judge against truth. See, you suspend your judgment. No judgment's happening. You already made the assertions. You already got the wow. Stop it, right? Don't try to make any more advance. Just make sure you don't judge against truth at this point. See, and that makes, then the momentum builds up in you and carries you forward. The momentum is not dissipated in this way. The way that we dissipate the momentum is we try to judge how successful we've been. Like, oh wow, let me judge this now, judge. And before I know it, we're using words and concepts, and then we're sliding into all sorts of judgment against truth, actually. And our momentum gets dissipated. And it's like we take two steps forward and two steps back, or three back, or whatever. And then this makes the whole path seems so difficult to us. Say, oh gosh, I can never succeed at this. I'm getting nowhere. It's like swimming against the current. You just don't get nowhere. So like it's like what we're doing is like, let's say we're in a river and there's a strong current. Well, maybe like we have a stone chained to us somehow, and we make a burst of effort and pull that stone forward against the current, and then let the stone drop. And then the current's hitting us, but it doesn't push us back at all because the stone is anchoring us. You see, we have some anchor. So then we make a burst and fling the anchor forward a little bit and go forward a little bit. Anchor. We're not being swept. We're not losing ground. So this is what we have to do when we're going against the current of expectations and familiarity. We have to make a burst of effort and then anchor. Burst of effort, anchor. Burst of effort, anchor. Burst of effort, anchor. Like that. Make the assertions, flip the script, make it, you know, get to the wow, and then anchor, no judgments. Don't let the judgments arise. Don't be tricked, and the ego says, wow, you look what a great job you did. How did you do that? And full stop on the wow. Don't answer. Silence. Oh, it's amazing you just got to the wow. How did you get to that wow? Silence. But you can't even tell me how you got to the well. But how are you going to get back to the well? Silence. Well, I mean, it's really important. You need to explain to everybody. It's so important how you did this. Silence. See, stay anchored. Once you make the advancement, then anchor. Stay anchored for a while until you catch your breath, and then you get enough strength to make another, you know, lunge forward, and then anchor yourself again. Because if you try to swim too much, you're going to get tired, and then you may advance, and then you get tired, and then you can't swim as strong, and then the river's going to push, the current's going to push you back, and you're going to lose ground. So you make an intense effort to go forward, and then anchor, like that. Now, there is a religious cartel in the world, too. I mean, just like the Washington cartel thinks they control politics, thinks they can tell everybody what to do and what their destinies are and what to think and what to say. And they're very cushy and comfortable and all bought off by lobbyists. And, you know, and it's just, you know, there is a very powerful Washington cartel, and the media protects them. And in turn, they get all sorts of special treatment. And there's a religious cartel in the world too, religious spiritual cartel that thinks that they can tell us how we're supposed to practice, what we're supposed to think, you know, what we're supposed to think Jesus is like this, or someone's like this, and this is how we're supposed to practice, and this is what we got to do, and all this. And they're, you know, very cushy in their positions of authority and power, and, you know, erudition, and thinking that everybody needs to do what they say. But, you know, we don't need to. We can stand up and say, this is how I'm practicing. Thank you, Jesus. This is a... And they say, well, Jesus is some, you know, evangelical, you know, I'm coming back to kill everybody, and Jesus is terrible. Say, no, this is how Jesus told me to practice. This is how I'm practicing. This works. You know, next, you know, we're done. We're done. All right, that's it. We're done. We're done with the press conference. You know, you don't sit there, let the media tell you when they're done with you, because when they're done with you, you'll just be a pile of bones on the floor, okay? The hyenas are after you. You know, the hyenas are, you know, they're going to demolish you and leave nothing but bones. So you decide what you're going to answer, and you decide when the press conference is over. You say, okay, we're done here. Thanks for coming. We're done. Okay, we're done here. Thanks for coming. Thanks for coming, everybody. Exit, like that, like that. You see? You don't let them dictate, you know, to you, like you got to stand up there and be a punching bag. No, you did not. So you don't have to explain this to organized religion or the spiritual mafia in the world or spiritual cartel or whatever it is. Many aspects to it. You just simply say, this is how I'm practicing. This is great. This is going to work. And this is going to lead to, you know, paradise, really, the death-free realm. And there's no doubt about it, when we suspend judgment like this, automatically we're going to gravitate towards pretending that we are eternal life. Automatically we're going to gravitate towards that, because that's what we really want. We just keep getting in our own way. See, we just have to get out of our way. And to do that is suspend all judgment. Suspend. Now, when we talk about judgment, we're not talking about evaluating our functioning, like driving or walking, running, working, you know, playing, eating, whatever. We're not. Though that's just evaluating our movement and activity and stuff. That's not what we're talking about, judgment. We're talking about judging what we are, what our identity is, what our being is. We suspend that judgment. We're thinking, oh, I know I'm this body, you know, I'm in this world, this is what I am, this is my identity, this is my life. That's judgment. That's judging against truth. That's judging against truth. There's no truth to any of that. I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. So what we need to do in suspending judgment is get out of our own way with these concepts and words and ideas and beliefs that we have. Just don't have any beliefs or ideas at all for a while. Just let the wow resonate. Now, if Jesus were to be here, well, we'd have a big wow, wouldn't we? It's like, wow, Jesus is here, wow. So what will we do? Full stop in the wow. We already know how to practice, so why are we afraid of Jesus? No matter how big the wow is, we say, well, I know how to practice. I'll just full stop in the wow. No judgment. I'm not trying to say, hey, this great, you're back, Jesus, and I'm going to measure how big the wow is. I'm not judging for this or against it. Neutral. Gone into the neutral wowness. And so we're not afraid anymore, are we? We're not afraid of what's really great. And we're not afraid of people bullying us. Not least we're trying to get up off the ground. I mean, we've been, the last 60 years in America, in the world in general, but especially in America, we have been absolutely pummeled and crushed by activists using the media to intimidate us, telling us what we need to think. And if we don't think that way, we don't deserve to exist. You know, that we don't deserve to have any voice at all. That we just have to be quiet, meekly quiet, and say, I can't have no opinion because I'm not at saying what they want me to say or thinking how they want me to think. And the media and entertainment industry is so powerful in America that we're just engulfed by it. Just engulfed by it. And they all act as if, you know, if you don't agree with them, you're the worst person in the world. And you don't even deserve to breathe. You know? Let alone say anything. Right? So it's this incredible intimidation and bullying that we've been subjected to, which is, you know, we're struggling to get it back on our feet here. And especially they think they can tell us how to think about Jesus. Okay, this is their real goal, because they know deep down, we know Jesus is coming back, and a lot of people are very frightened about this. He's already back, and so they failed to block him. They failed to block him. They thought they could block him by nobody being responsive to him here, but he came back anyway. He said, okay, anybody willing to relate with me, you know, I'm here. He came back. So their primary objective was to block him from coming back by just complete disinterest here. Everybody just crazy, and you know, a bunch of straw men making idols and straw men of him, and nobody really able to relate with him at all. So, you know, they hoped that he would say, oh, well, nothing really here. I can't really succeed here. I'm not going to come back. That's what they hope. They've already failed at that. Devastating failure. Devastating failure for the global cartel here, who doesn't want Jesus back because he gets in the way of our pretending to be dead. You see, they're nervous. He makes them very nervous because they might blow our cover. You know, Jesus might blow my cover. They're thinking they might blow my cover. Oh my gosh, how terrible. They're worried about it. And so number one, massive failure on their part right there. They didn't succeed. Now they're trying to keep us from relating with Jesus by intimidating us and telling us what Jesus is really about. You see all these magazines, you know, Time, Newsweek. I don't know if Newsweek still publishing, maybe not. But all these various magazines and blogs and glorified blogs and, you know, internet stuff and you know, information, media, entertainment, everything. They keep coming out with all these articles on Jesus. You know, it's so important. They keep having these movies on Jesus and stuff. They're trying to tell us what Jesus is. They're trying to tell us without us actually relating with Jesus and finding out what Jesus is really about. They say, no, let us tell you. Let Hollywood tell you about Jesus. Are you going to accept Hollywood's version of what Jesus is? Are you going to say, oh, okay, I'm going to believe this, and I'm going to stake my future destiny on what Hollywood says about Jesus, or what some of these magazines or blogs say about Jesus? Is that what you're going to do? Because that's what they want you to do. And then, of course, they'll tell you, he doesn't have much to say about this or much to say about that. You can't go to him for this or that, you know. But if you just, you know, bring some canned food to your local church, Jesus, two thumbs up and you're good to go. You know, that's it. You get to keep your status as being dead. Like, you know, that's what they're really saying. Guess what? Jesus is going to let you keep your status of being dead. He's not into changing that at all. No. In fact, he hates that. In fact, he already died perfectly, so you don't have to worry. You have perfect death status with guilt already, so it's already done. You know. Now, Jesus is coming back to tell us, hey, you are just pretending to be dead, but guess what? You can change that to pretending to be eternal life. And that's why I came back. Remember, he said, I came to give you eternal life. He who tries to find his life shall lose it. In other words, he who tries to find life through pretending to be dead will lose it. And he who should give up his life for my sake shall have eternal life. Meaning, he who gives up the charade of pretending to be dead, which we call life, will end up gaining pretending to be eternal life. So that little caveat, pretending to be, is the intermediate step. And then from there, we will then simply be eternal life as God created us. We'll be fully aware of this. So Jesus did come to this world to call us out of this pretense of pretending to be dead, so then we can pretend to be eternal life. That's exactly why Jesus came. And of course, the whole world is telling us that no, that's not Jesus. Jesus came to make sure that you distributed food properly and made sure everybody was, you know, clothed and housed and be good to your neighbor he's the model socialist. You know, that's what Jesus is all about. That's what they're trying to say. He's just a social activist. wants us to be happy being dead, you know, pretending to be dead. We want to, you know, have good schools, good churches, good careers, good marriage, good friends, and then we die, and that's what Jesus wants. That's what they're telling us. You know, there's nothing else to see. Nothing else to see. He's just a good guy, nice guy. Or also they say, well, yeah, he really didn't exist. I think there's no evidence he ever existed, you know, so how can he come back if he never existed? It's some kind of tooth fairy tale here. I mean, crazy. The crazies are waking up the crazies, you know. We don't want to wake up the crazies here. We don't want Jesus coming back and waking up the crazies, because how can he come back? He never was here. That's what they say, too. And so this is the narrative. We keep hearing this narrative from all different directions. And to ignore this narrative is quite a challenge. Quite a challenge that I've been through. So there are many who want to relate with Jesus. I saw this when he said, I'm back, announced to the whole world. And who wants to relate with me? I looked around. I said, who's going to raise their hand? I was wondering, anybody? And there was a lot of eyes looking at him. I knew they heard him. But they're kind of wondering, who's going to go first? You know, do I have to do it? I don't know. I'm not sure. Maybe the media might be mad with me and say I'm a crazy or something. I better not do it. And I said, wow. Nobody's raising their hand. I said, this is terrible. Jesus come back and he helped us all prepare. And nobody's raising their hand. I said, holy cow. This is a disaster. And so finally I just said, well, you know what? You know, I can't let this stand. I've got to raise my hand. It's plain and simple. So I raised my hand. And he said, great. You want to relate? I said, yeah. He said, okay, great. And then we had a little powwow, and we went over some stuff. And it was great. I was a little nervous. There are a lot who want to. There's a lot who want to. So those are the ones that need to start realizing, hey, yes, I can. Yes, I can. Yes, I can. You know, so doing it, standing up to the spiritual cartel of this planet and saying, no, I'm going to go ahead and do it anyway. I don't need your permission. I don't need your permission. I don't need to be lectured. You know, don't need to be lectured. I don't need your permission. I'm going to go ahead and do it, and I am doing it. You know, this attitude is very helpful. Very helpful. So this is the kind of leadership we need now in the world, in various ways of saying, hey, you know, I'm standing up to the bullies. We don't have to be bullied anymore. You know, we can speak our mind. We don't need to be bullied by PC police, you know, by spiritual police, PC police, whatever. They're telling us, you know, what we can say, what we can't say. Oh, you can't talk about Jesus that way. That's not politically correct. You know, say, hey, don't lecture me. You don't tell me, you know, we're done here. You don't tell me how I relate to Jesus. That's between me and Jesus. And we're done here. That's it. All right, so just start getting some wind in your sails. Start getting some wind in your sails. Just keep working at it. Keep working at getting some wind in your sails. This is very important, because the plan of the world spirit is trying to convince guilt that it's dead, and it's going to really double down on this, you know, double down on it and try to really say, wow, I haven't convinced guilt yet, but if I just really double down and really make it seem like this world is very deathy, I made up a world very deathy, full of deathy, it's very deathy, even more so than ever, then this will finally convince guilt, you know, and it's very worried that Jesus is going to blow our cover. So of course it's frantically trying to prepare things for all sorts of deathiness to occur, and we don't want to be part of that. It's not necessary at all. So get some wind in your sails. Get some wind in your sails here. And I'm trying to do everything I can do. I don't know where to put the pictures. I've been putting them all over the place, but I don't like Flickr. It's the worst site on the internet as far as slowness is concerned. It absolutely drives me crazy. My computer cannot handle Flickr at all. It handles every other website, but Flickr, no. And I just can't go there. I cannot go there. So it gives you a lot of space to put pictures, but I don't know if I want to torture people by having to go to Flickr to look at some pictures. I put them on my Facebook page under photos. They're all there. Facebook's also a little slow. I'll look into it. I'll look into it. I'm trying to get you know, Mimi posters out on Jesus so people can start posting them on their Facebook pages. Post them on your Facebook page. Post them everywhere. Post them. Start posting Jesus posters. You know? Friend Jesus. Start friending Jesus. This is what it's about. Start getting the wind in your sails. And I know people say, hey, why are you supporting Jesus? Because, you know, Jesus did this and this and da 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 da. Straw man, you know, straw man. Well, I'm not going to let all these straw men that people made cause me to then stay away from Jesus. That's ridiculous. That's what they want. So it's time to, you know, get over it. You know, get over this bias against Jesus that people have. It's time to get over that. And it's time to acknowledge that Jesus is a, you know, super great spiritual teacher. There is no better, you know. I'm not saying that there aren't others that could be as good, okay? And that's, you know, why should we judge that way? We don't have to. But I'll tell you this, there isn't any better. And I can say that with conviction. So, you know, why should we feel embarrassed about that? It's ridiculous. We're not embarrassed about listening to the greatest spiritual teacher ever, with one who doesn't have anyone, the one who has no one superior to him as far as spiritual teaching. Why should we feel embarrassed about that? That's utterly ludicrous. It's the real fear is that they're afraid that we'll blow everyone's cover here. Say, oh my gosh, we're not really dead. Spirit's not really dead. Oh my gosh, guilt is now going to annihilate us. We thought we. You see, when we tried to change reality and nothing happened, we thought okay. We said, oh no, we did annihilate it. But then we think, uh oh, we're part of reality. So we must have annihilated ourselves. But again, quickly we said, real quickly, oh, I'll pretend to be dead, and then spirit will look at that and say, oh yeah, okay. Yeah, spirit died too. Yeah, spirit's dead too. But meanwhile, this is just pretense. We're just pretending. This is a dream. We're going to do a dream that we died, hoping that the dream would convince death that the dream was real. And then once that happened, guilt would vanish along with the dream, and we'd be, you know, perfectly free and happy and eternal life, except we'd now be the prime creator, and God would be gone. And this is what we have been working on. And it's what we need to get free from, you know, set down. So let's pretend to be eternal life. Let's pretend to be eternal life. Jesus knows the way to pretend to be eternal life. He knows the way. So we will see how this unfolds. We could do it, you know. I have all these graphics that can be posted anywhere. Post it on your blog. You know, this is what I'd like to see, is just this whole grassroots, you know, flooding of the internet and the world. Just say positive message. Jesus this, Jesus this, Jesus this. And start standing up for Jesus. Even though others, you know, may not be criticizing you and thinking, well, that's not the traditional Christian message. Well, that's right. Because the traditional Christian message, the belief that Jesus actually paid the price that guilt demanded, which is the death of spirit, that Jesus actually paid that price and therefore then freed us, that we don't have to pay the price, is ridiculous. It's ridiculous. It's exactly opposite of what Jesus was all about. He said there is no price to pay. We're only pretending to be dead. Jesus' resurrection was showing us that we're only pretending to die. It's all pretense. And then he's leaving this world and says, hey, you don't have to stay here. Once you give up your pretense, you can go to the kingdom of God, the death-free realm, paradise. You know, pretend to be eternal life. That's the option you have. So, yeah, I mean, traditional Christians may think that you're, you know, what are you talking about? But there are quite a few, actually, in the world who have rethought the whole thing and said, wait a minute, you know, there must be a better explanation. This one that we have just hasn't really worked for us, has it? And so there are many Christians who have rethought the situation. There are many agnostics who have rethought. There may even be many atheists who have rethought. There may be many people of all religions who have rethought the situation and said, wait a minute, maybe this is all just a pretense. You know, maybe we are pretending to be dead in order so that guilt doesn't really get us and accepts this substitute, you know, this fake substitute, thinking, okay, spirit's dead. That's it. Game over. And maybe that is true. You know, maybe it is true. And they're starting, you know, to resonate with this. So, I don't know how it'll go, but we'll see. And I know that every day we have to go really big. Go really big, really, really, really big. So, I've tried to do that today. I'm going to keep on trying. And every day I wake up, I think, what can I do that just, you know, trumps what I did yesterday? Trump is an interesting word to use right now. You know, you just need, every day is bigger. Every day it's bigger, you know. Just go bigger every day. And this is where we're at now. It's better than the 60s. Right now it's better than the 60s, actually. We can make it so. We can make it so. Now, the 60s had a lot of graphic art, you know, a lot of art that people were using to, you know, tune into it. So I'm producing a lot of very cool graphic art to tune in to Jesus, because what is Jesus about? Practice, right? Effective practice, which enables us to shift from pretending that we're dead to pretending that we're eternal life. And what could be better than that? What could be better than that? Even the 60s couldn't figure that one out. We didn't know. Back in the 60s, we didn't know. I'm telling you, we did not know. But we had a longing. We said, we want to know. And then, of course, the miracles actually started being transmitted by Jesus in the 60s, during the 60s. I think it started about, what, 1964, 5 or whatever, 63. I don't know. It started in the 60s and then was finally made into a book presentable to us in the 70s, 76 or something like that. So there was this feeling like, you know what, there's some deeper truth we got to find, but we didn't know what it was. It's been 40 years plus for me. I mean, I started the day I got here in this world, but the 60s, you know, you could say it's been more than 40 years for me of desperately trying to find the truth. And now I believe I have it. I believe I have it, that I understand that's about right practice, and what is the right practice, and what's the goal of the right practice. And yes, we can succeed at this. Absolutely, we will succeed at this. Just don't judge against truth. It's very simple. Don't judge against truth. So we're better off now than we were in the 60s spiritually. We're better off, way better off. And people need to start realizing this and waking up to this fact. You know, don't worry if you went around in the 60s, it's okay. We're better off if you can accept it. We have better understanding, way better understanding. I mean, was there anyone around who spoke English in the Western that was presenting this information? Not that I'm aware of. No, not like this. Not with this kind of clarity and some streamlined simplicity, you know, and saying that Jesus is the one that is behind this all, and the Holy Spirit. There wasn't anyone like that. I mean, we might have had some people over in India that were enlightened. No, in fact, we did. But that was steeped in the culture and tradition, Vedic tradition of India. You know, for 4,000 years of tradition, they stayed within that tradition to a large extent. So we really didn't have, you know, this kind of real punchy clarity, you know. Did not have it. And I said, wow, this is terrible. So I said,